Come on down. It's time for Eye on L.A. Tonight, make a deal and spin the wheel as we search for the funniest and most bizarre game shows in the world.
No way.
Yes, from Italy, it's the Peel of Fortune, when ordinary homemakers play housewives strip poker.
Oh, I don't believe it.
Then, from England, contestants get the Royal Flush, or a date of their dreams. It's Kiss or Squirt.
Really?
Yes, then it's humiliation. With a twist, how would you like to eat sheep's brains or run through a ring of fire doused with gasoline?
Oh, that sounds like fun.
From Japan, it's time to play Endurance.
It's amazing, isn't it?
American TV was never like this.
We could never do to American contestants what the Japanese do.
Tonight, we span the globe. It's like... to bring you the ultimate in game show competition.
What a lineup.
This is the International Game Show edition of Eye on L.A.
Hi, everybody. I'm Chuck Henry. Did you know that television has been around for almost 40 years now? And one of the first shows on television was the game show, shows like $64,000 Question and Beat the Clock. Relatively inexpensive to produce, but a lot of fun to watch. And it was only natural that they'd be exported to foreign markets once TV caught on around the world. But a lot has changed in foreign TV game shows. In fact, some people believe that these foreign game show producers have actually beaten our guys at their own game.
As they have with so many other American imports, the Japanese have embraced our style of television with an enthusiasm few would have predicted in the post-war haze of 1945. But they love television and have a thriving commercial system that's the envy of the rest of the world. So it figures that in this competitive go-getter society, the game show commands lots of attention. Japanese game shows seem to be one part intelligence test, two parts travelogue. 120 million people are corralled on this island country about the size of California, and they're understandably eager to learn about foreign lands. They look to TV to provide vicarious vacations. Each week on Naruhodo the World, contestants hook up via satellite with traveling hosts. Today they're looking in on Dublin, and these young married couples compete in games of observation about the geography, customs, or curiosities of the place. For example, kissing the Blarney Stone to get the gift of gab.
If Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers, a peck of pickled peppers, Peter Piper picked.
Do you think the same rules apply when the kisser is Japanese? Only if you think this is a tongue twister. Next to travel, the Japanese love their fabled technology. So on Naruhodo, players have to guess what makes some of these new inventions so special, like this zippy two-seater. Hey, now he's got it. The winner! And what fantastic prizes! But these city stereos are the jackpot compared to the sushi sets, houseplants, or the throw pillows they could have won. Of course, by our standards, this is all pretty tame. And with the flashy set, bickering contestants, and grinning hosts, it looks pretty much like one of our game shows. But for a peek at how the Japanese have revolutionized the form, look no further than the mega hit Ultra Quiz. And for 6 hours each year, most of Japan does just that. This globe-trotting challenge of intelligence, creative thinking, and sheer stamina is in its fifth year as Japan's ultimate entertainment and turns ordinary students into national heroes. The object of Ultra Quiz is survival. You start with 10,000 contestants in a Tokyo stadium. Ask them a true or false question. Almost half of the crowd will be eliminated for making the wrong choice, in this case, choosing the wrong symbol to represent their answer. Two other tougher questions narrow the field down to the lucky 100. who becomes swept up in the excitement of travel and opportunity that awaits those who have survived this far. They're flown to Guam for the second leg of the competition. Now, this is where the show gets weird. While on the plane to Guam, the producers give a general knowledge test. A passing grade means you continue in the competition. But if you don't cut the mustard, they don't even let you set foot on the island, and you're returned home, dishonored. Yeah, some fun, huh? Well, now we start to see the cultural difference. Not only does Ultra Quiz glorify the winners, they focus on the disappointment of losing, all in the name of entertainment. Still, for the survivors, the quest to be king of quiz starts in earnest with another true-false test. Make your guess and head for the circle or the square. If you're right, you come away clean. But if you're wrong, your name is Mud. Literally. And once again, we see this strange preoccupation with failure. It's make a mistake, pack up your bags, and sayonara. But not before the ritual of humiliation, like a sunburn that proclaims, I am a loser. From the sun and fun of the islands, it's off to snow-covered peaks for a slippery game of musical chairs played on ice. Then, at Long Beach's Queen Mary, they play the old TV game of concentration. But this time, instead of matching up prizes, they match up identical twins.
Number 10.
Next, the heat is on in Death Valley, where an unusual variation on strip poker has contestants put on clothes if they answer incorrectly.
Ohayo, genki ka? Iwasa-kun.
1923年.
Matsumoto-san.
1913年.
You can bet in this 115 degree heat that there's a lot of motivation to be right.
問題. 昔の中国で一回り. Iwasa-kun.
Horun.
Trompo.
While not exactly life-threatening, competition like this does fall into the don't-try-this-at-home category. But surprisingly, no contestant has ever been seriously injured while playing Ultra Quiz. And nobody has complained of their treatment while in the custody of the show. In Japan, being on Ultra Quiz is an honor. And that's more important than danger or discomfort. It's even more important than winning, though after going through all of this, it might be nice. So after 10 competitive checkpoints, thousands of miles and days of quizzing, it comes down to this. From 10,000 hopefuls to two men atop the World Trade Center in New York City. With one question standing between them and the distinction of being king of quiz. Of course, if these were American contestants, the question would probably be, was it all worth it? But that's part of the charm of the Asian approach to game shows. No big prizes, no greed, just the honor of the competition and the chance to be famous, at least until next year.
Along with a flag and the honors, that guy also won a log cabin. The only problem is he's got to build it himself. But of course, that should be no problem for that guy compared to what he just went through on Ultra Quiz. Coming up next, it's off to the continent to see British and French TV game shows. So don't go away. Those Japanese game shows are really something. And American producers have tried to borrow their formula of faraway places and physical stunts, but without much success. I guess as Americans, we're more interested in big bucks than we are a big adventure. And that makes us unique, because in other parts of the world, it's not what you win, but it's the thrill of playing the game that counts.
Mesdames et messieurs, bonsoir. Le match.
Did I say thrill? Well, in France, that word is open to interpretation. Now, this tedium has millions of Frenchmen glued to les télévisions each week. It's sort of a Parisian prototype of Scrabble called Des Chiffres and Des Lettres. And it combines all of the excitement of hangmen with the drama of an eighth grade arithmetic bee. These incredibly long silences give our host plenty of time for contemplation. He's probably trying to remember the French word for boredom right now. Still, one Gallic game show is truly world-class. It's called Puzzle at the Ends of the Earth. It serves up contestants on satellite hookup from all over the globe. They're connected to the Paris-based host by headset and must answer brain-bruising questions about the history and culture of their locales, like this dike vaulter in the Netherlands.
Question. Dans la région de Beauvoir-sur-Mer, le vin traditionnel est le blanc royal, le franc blanc ou le blanc du marais?
Le blanc du marais?
Non, le franc blanc.
Or this precariously strung out woman in Istanbul.
Question. Dans la salle du divan, il y avait une seule fenêtre. À quoi servait-elle? À l'aération? À envoyer des parfums ou à surveiller le conseil?
Surveiller le conseil,
c'est exact, elle était grillagée.
The British are renowned for the quality of their television, which, like their country, is formal, reserved, and above all, dignified.
Squirt!
Right, now what's that say?
Oh, shh.
Kiss.
It says what?
Oh. Kiss.
Kiss!
On Game for a Laugh, the British penchant for baggy pants humor lets loose, usually at the expense of some poor, unsuspecting contestants like these.
Oh, dearie me, dearie me. Yeah,
okay, pick it up. Only go. What's it say? Quickly.
Kiss.
Kiss!
Now, this unlucky chap must choose his fate, either a kiss from Miss World or a kisser full of seltzer.
Kiss.
In the United Kingdom, antics like this have audiences roaring, much as American folks did at Truth or Consequences more than 20 years ago. But not all British game shows play it for laughs. Treasure Hunt goes in for action.
Hello. On this week's Treasure Hunt, our skyrunner, Annika Rice, will be guided by Celia Robertson and Mary Trinder.
Tell us
a bit about yourselves.
I'm a teacher of swimming, full-time. And,
oh, really?
And I love it.
I'm a housewife for 8 months of the year, and the other 4 months I update the electoral roll.
Players use a shelf full of books and a live headset hookup to lead hostess Annika Rice and her very fit camera crew all over the countryside in search of the treasure. Annie's breathless treks through places like Stratford-on-Avon and the French Riviera have given her the most recognizable backside on the telly.
Can you get into the helicopter,
right,
please?
But sometimes she has to put her famous fanny on the line. Like when she takes the plunge in order to beat the clock and win the game for her excited guys.
Come on, Annie, jump. Great. A very damp Annie.
Very damp Annie, yes. Well.
Oh, my gosh,
she's got a flag. She's got a flag. She's waving a flag.
Done
right.
Extremely well to get it, and here's your prize of $1,000.
Oh, Mary!
Which I hope you're going to share between you. I don't know.
Oh, there's her share. She has it. We'll
go another treasure hunt next week. Until then, goodbye.
Don't go away, because coming up next, we've got some of the strangest television you've ever seen.